Prophet, the role model for Islamic leadership. It's a leadership story. It's a successful leadership story. Each and every one of us should take the Prophet as a role model. Whenever any of us is asked to take a certain leadership position, whether at home, being the head of the family, or at work, or anywhere else in life, he needs to take the Prophet as his role model. Where the people that you are leading, they need to see that you have positively impacted their life. They need to see that you have positively impacted your life. Otherwise, they do not need you as a leader. If you are unable to positively impact their life, their day-to-day life, their livelihood, they would not really be requiring a leader. So it's a leadership story, a successful leadership story. Today I'm going to talk about the Prophet's leadership, not in terms of how he improved the salah of the people, how he taught them the salah, or how he taught them as-sawm or al-hajj, or how he improved their hereafter for them, which in fact is the most important thing that the Prophet had done. The most important thing that the Prophet had done was that he reformed the hereafter of the people, and Allah sent him to reform the hereafter of the people, to move them from a path that was heading to the hellfire to a path that would be heading to Al-Jannah. We talk for so long about this aspect, and we need to talk more and more about it. But I would like to talk about another aspect, about other things that the Prophet had done in his leadership, where he improved the day-to-day life of the people, the day-to-day life of the people as a leader. So many of us think of the Prophet's leadership of Al-Madinah to be rather easy. We imagine that he emigrated with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu to Al-Madinah, and then waves of Muslim immigrants started to catch up with them, and they were already going there before them. And the Al-Ansar were generous enough to accommodate the waves of the Muslim immigrants in their own homes. And the problem is solved. And whenever it's time to defend Islam or Al-Madina, the Prophet calls Hayya ala al-Jihad, and then everybody carries his sword and rides a camel horse, and then they go and fight a battle, and then Allah supports them and they win, and that's it. It's very simple. No, it wasn't simple like this. It was not simple like this. It was very complicated. And this is what I want to be able to reflect today, the challenges that faced Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a leader in his leadership mission for Al-Madinah. In the beginning, let's look at the condition of Al-Madinah when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam emigrated to it. It was not called Al-Madinah at that time. It was called Yathrib. It was called Yathrib. The name Al-Madinah came later. Al-Madinah was not really a safe place at all. There were fights, constant fights between the two main tribes of Al-Madinah, Al-Aws and Al-Khazraj, for tens of years. Constant fights and bloodshed between the two, and mutual revenge between the two biggest tribes of Al-Madinah. And there were three main Jewish tribes who were living at the outskirts of Al-Madinah, the southern outskirts of Al-Madinah, and they were practically in control of the economy. The Arab tribes in Al-Madinah were mainly working in agriculture. They were mainly farmers. The Jews had farms, had agriculture. They had manufacturing. They were working with the gold. They were also blacksmiths. They were also goldsmiths. They had also some manufacturing of light things like weapons, swords, etc. They were manufacturing these things. They were in control of the markets. They were controlling the trade. And they were controlling the money. They were controlling the money in Medina. Anybody needs money? Welcome. We lend you money with riba. And stay stuck for the rest of your life. Otherwise, sell me your house, or your land, or your farm. It was not a pleasant place to live in at all, Al-Medina. And the Prophet had to establish his new Islamic state there, in Al-Medina, in this place. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam initially was faced with the problem of the waves of the immigrants that were arriving to Al-Medina. What was the population of Al-Medina at the time when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam reached it? I actually researched that subject, and the most logical number that I could arrive at was that they were anywhere between 10,000, 12,000, something like that, maybe 15. It was like a village in our today's standards. But then it is estimated, of course these are estimations, right, from Islamic historians, that by the time the Prophet died, the population was roughly about 30,000, 30,000. Meaning, in a time of 10 years, the population of Medina had actually increased 2 to 3 times. 2 to 3 times. We can imagine that those people who had been coming, leaving their homes, their lands, their businesses, everything they owned, to come to Al-Medina, you know what? They were human beings like us. Can you believe that or not? You know, a lot of times we just don't seem to think about it like this. They had needs like us. They were not angels just ready to pray at night and fast Ramadan and then go and carry a sword to fight in a battle. They were really human beings like us. They had human needs. They had families. They had children that they wanted to house. They were honorable enough that one of them, I'm talking about Al-Muhajirin, even though the Ansar people, were generous enough to accommodate them in their homes, they were honorable enough not to accept that as a permanent solution. A guest could be tolerated for some time, but not forever. Particularly if you're dealing with the honorable Arabs. You know, the Arabs had quite a bit of pride and dignity, and that wouldn't be a permanent solution. The Prophet could not depend on that as being a permanent solution for the people. So as a leader, the people were expecting him to solve that problem for them. Remember, I'm talking about the Prophet as a role model leadership, a leader who reforms the people's life so that we take him as a role model. If you are a manager in your company or at work, your employees, whether they are Muslims or non-Muslims, they need to see that you have been able to positively impact their life as individuals, even at home with their own children, that you have given them opportunities. But it wasn't really so easy to deal with all of those problems. Al-Medina had quite a diverse population. In Al-Madinah there were mushrikeen. Some of the people of Al-Madinah, they did not accept Islam. They remained mushrikeen. They were worshipping idols. And there were the Jews. And then there were the Bedouins who were kind of living around Al-Madinah, in the desert around Al-Madinah. And there were minorities of Christians and Al-Majus, people who worship fire, etc. Just really minorities of those people. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, in order for him to meet all of the, let me call it, state's requirement, he had to improve the economy. He had to meet the people's urban planning requirements. They needed homes, they needed work, they needed food, they needed roads. Remember, they were human beings like us. What would you need if you go to a new place? They needed it. And believe it or not, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as a leader, met all of those things for them. But we just don't talk so much about that. So in the beginning, the Prophet could not reform anything in Al-Madinah without achieving peace in Al-Madinah. That's the first thing to be done. So he had to achieve peace between Al-Aws wal Khazraj. And also he had to contain the Jewish tribes who were at the outskirts of Al-Madinah, who were in control of the economy and the business. He had to contain them. He had to make sure that they would not become a source of trouble. And he also had to contain the people who were still mushrikeen, who were living in Al-Madinah. And don't forget that he also needed to solve the livelihood problems of the immigrants. But what to do? Yathrib was really a bad name. Yathrib was a bad name, a name for wars, a name for revenges that were taking place for a long time, bloodshed. So the first thing that he did, he wiped off the name Yathrib and he changed the name of Yathrib to Al-Madinah. Prophet, the greatest psychologist in our today's terminologies. All of a sudden, the people are really living in a new place when they haven't even moved an inch. But they are really in a new place now. They're in a place called Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara, the illuminating city. And Yathrib is gone. Yathrib, with its bad old days memories, are gone. By one decision, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam prepared them psychologically for a change. He's a role model for each and every one of us. Now he needed to solve the problems of the immigrants. He just needed a quick solution. The quickest solution was to achieve this brotherhood, al-mu'akha, as we said, between the immigrants and al-ansar, where the ansar were accommodating every ansar family, were accommodating a muhajirin family. But this is not enough. The Prophet was a political leader. He's a role model for all political leaders. He was leading a diverse population. That diverse population, they needed to know where they stand in this new place. They needed to know what were their rights and obligations, where they fit. Were they going to be treated as ignored minorities? No. Islam doesn't ignore any minorities. There are no minorities in Islam. One person in Islam, if he has a right, then he is a majority until his right is given back to him. So the Prophet had to establish a constitution. You know, so many people do not know about that aspect. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam established a constitution, and some of the Islamic historians like Muhammad Umara and others, they say that this is the first more or less complete constitution in the world. A complete constitution in the world. He made a constitution where he agreed to that constitution with all of the constituents of Al-Madina, with the Muslims, Al-Aus tribes, Al-Khazraj tribes, the Jews, as well as the Mushrikeen. They all had agreed to that constitution. In Arabic, it's called As-Sahifa. As-Sahifa. If you go to Google and write the Prophet's first constitution in Medina, or in Arabic, Sahifat al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you will see it. You will see it. The historians received it as just like a kind of a complete text. And then the historians differed in whether to split that text into 44 clauses or 52 clauses or 64 clauses. That's why you will find that the number of clauses, if you go back to Sheikh Gogol, you will see that Sheikh Gogol gives the same text to you in different clause numbers. And that's as split by the historians. But the text is more or less the same. That text stated that all of the people are free to practice their religions, whatever their religion was. That constitution stated that there is no compulsion in religion, لا إكراه في الدين. All people are free to practice their own religion. And that all people, particularly the Muslims and the Jews, who were kind of the biggest two portions of Al-Madinah, that they would stand together in defending Al-Madinah from any attacker. They would stand together, the Muslims and the Jews, and they would support one another financially and with the weapons, and even in the fighting, if needed, to support Al-Madinah. That they were all equal citizens of that state. And therefore, they had equal responsibility in defending that state. And everybody was free to practice his own religion freely, no compulsion in religion. There's nothing new in this, right? Allah said it in the Quran. And that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the leader of Al-Madinah. So now, when the constitution has been agreed, now he's ready to work. In fact, it is said that this constitution was kind of formulated like 6 months after he settled in Al-Madinah, but he was working on it at that time. And it's also said that, you know, bits and pieces were being added to it with the passage of time according to the changes that were happening. The first thing that the Prophet did when he arrived in Al-Madinah, he built the masjid. The masjid was initially small, and then it was made bigger as the population increased. The masjid has so many duties. It was a place where all Muslims meet and receive the teachings and directions of Islam through the Prophet. It was a forum where all the tribal representatives and figures would meet together after they had been distancing themselves from one another due to the continuous wars and disputes that were between them during the Jahiliya time. Those dignitaries of Al-Aus and Al-Khazraj who were enemies to one another. Now, after they have accepted Islam, you know, and there's still something in the heart. He killed my cousin. He killed my son. There's something in the heart. Yes, we became Muslims, but I don't want to be anywhere close to him. No? You're going to have to come to the masjid, and you're going to stand by him shoulder to shoulder, feet to feet. And they did that. And then the hearts became closer to one another. The masjid was also a base for running all of the internal and external affairs of the newly established state. It was a parliament place. I'm using current day terminology so just we may understand it. It wasn't really called the parliament, a parliament at that time. It's just only for us to understand. It was like a parliament place where all consultations would be held between all concerned parties. مكان للشورى, للشورى. A place of shelter to a fairly large number of muhajirin, homeless muhajirin, homeless people who had no money, no families in Medina to help them, and no place to shelter them. And believe it or not, the masjid was also a place for receiving the delegates of the Jews, of the mushrikeen, kuffar, would enter to the masjid of the Prophet. Yes, that's how it was. Mushrikeen were coming to the masjid, delegates of the mushrikeen were coming to the masjid of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that was a place for Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to make da'wah for them. And also, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam received Christians. We all know that he received the delegation of the Christians of Nasran, of Najran. And their story is quite famous. He received them in al-masjid. You know, believe it or not, the masjid, he allowed also some fun, some entertainment to take place in the masjid. He allowed a group of Ethiopians to come and perform a play with their spears. They were performing a play with their spears, a group of Ethiopians, and the hadith is famous when our mother, may Allah be pleased with her, Aisha, was watching them playing with their spears in the masjid, and she was putting her chin on the shoulder of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, watching them. The mosque was not like our mosques now, that just restricted to the salah. The whole life activities were taking place in the masjid. That actually was an indication of the universality of Islam, and that a new era has come for the entire humanity where they could all be tied together through faith and the belief in Allah. People coming to settle in Al-Madinah, they needed places to live. As we said, the Muhajirin were honorable enough not to accept to remain as guests for the rest of their lives. So Al-Ansar had offered Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam pieces of land between their neighborhoods. The Medina, as it is said from some of the references, it was like if you have a, make a circle 1 kilometer radius, 1 kilometer radius, it is said that this was the inhabited area of Al-Madinah. So from end to end, like 2 kilometers. You could imagine a square of 2 by 2, 4 square kilometers. That's the inhabited area. But then they had their own lands and farms and other places outside that. And there was a lot of gaps between their neighborhoods because they did not want to be close to one another. They had ill feelings from the fights that were going on. And they gave those deserted lands to the Prophet. So Prophet established new neighborhoods in those places where now he's connecting the neighborhoods together. And he gave it to the Muhajirin to actually establish homes there. And he actually allowed people to establish neighborhood mosques in their own neighborhoods. But the Jum'ah would be performed in the masjid of the Prophet. Just like us, you know, believe it or not, people needed paved roads. It's not only us who need paved roads. It's not logical that they were just running their horses and wagons on bumpy roads. They also needed paved roads. Yes, they didn't have the asphalt or the black tar, but they had their own way of paving roads. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam paved roads for them. Wide roads between the neighborhoods, and then when the roads enter the neighborhood, they would become smaller. In fact, there is hadith to Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, hadith في الصحيحين, رواه أبو هريرة أن الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم قال, now he passed regulations about the width of the roads. Regulations about the width of the road, yes, because Islam is a complete way of life. Islam came to reform this life as well as the hereafter. Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إذا اختلفتم في الطريق فاجعلوه سبعة أذرع. He said, if you do not reach agreement amongst yourselves over the width of a road, then make it seven arms length. The scholars estimated an arm's length as 55 or 56 centimeters, meaning that if you disagree, what should be the width of a road, make it 4 meters. He was passing regulations also for that. People needed food. People needed to work. The population was increasing from 1 up to 3 times. What to do? The expectations was from him, the leader. The leader of Al-Madinah, Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, who is a role model for us. So how to feed all of those people? Almost all of the good fertile land was already being used. And there was lots of non-fertile lands, barren lands. Al-Ansar gave those lands to Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. And then the Prophet said, who wants to work? Here is this non-fertile land. Here is this barren land. You roll up your sleeves and you go and work. You go and work. And you improve that land and you employ yourself as well as employ your brothers who are jobless. And the Sahaba rolled up their sleeves and they took those barren lands, those non-fertile lands, and there was the innovation even in how to improve that land. And all of a sudden, the Medina was able to provide food for all of the immigrants and more. Now, they needed marketplaces. They needed marketplaces to actually sell their products and also buy. But the marketplaces are controlled by the Jews. And the way that the Jews were running the business is something that Islam would not allow. The Islamic dealing where you have to practice truth in buying and selling. Prohibition of riba. The Jews' markets was based on riba. Prohibition of monopoly. The Jews' market in Al-Madina was based on monopoly. Prohibition of cheating. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as a leader, realized that the people wanted the marketplace. So he went and tried to establish a marketplace near a marketplace of Banu Qaynuqa, you know, because normally the marketplace should be in one direction so that you could buy from this market if you want, or that, or that, or that. So he established a marketplace near the marketplace of Banu Qaynuqa. The Jews came and demolished it for him. The Prophet said, all right, we don't want any conflicts. And he asked that a different place become the marketplace for the Muslims. And he said in one of his hadiths, he said, نِعْمَ السُّوقَ سُوقَكُمْ هَذَا فَلَا يُنْقَصَنَّ وَلَا يُضْرَبَنَّ عَلَيْكُمْ بِخَرَاجِ. They came to a big area and they circled it and said, this is now your marketplace. That's all what it takes, is a regulation from the government to say, this is the marketplace. And people would go to that marketplace. He said, this is a good marketplace for you indeed. In this marketplace, your profits shall not be reduced by enforcement of fees, nor get taxed. فَلَا يُنْقَصَنَّ وَلَا يُضْرَبَنَّ عَلَيْكُمْ بِخَرَاجِ. So in that marketplace, you're not going to be paying any rent, you're not going to be paying any taxes. أول سوق حرة في العالم. It's the first free market there. Buy and sell. No taxes, no fees. Okay, which means that the rich people would go there and they would rent the place. No, there is no rent. Umar ibn al-Khattab actually said, "Al-aswaq 'ala sunnat al-masajid," meaning that the mosque will be like, meaning that the marketplace will be like the mosque. Who gets in first, takes a place, and sells his products until He's done. When he leaves, somebody else comes in. So the poorest of the poor, all he needed to do is just to go early. And apparently, the poor normally go earlier, wake up earlier than the rich. The rich probably eats up at night, so he sleeps more. So people were finding now a new marketplace to buy and sell. In short, the Prophet took care of the economy. The Prophet improved people's lives. Without a strong economy and a stable society, with the constitution that he made in the beginning, the Prophet would not have been able to win the Battle of Badr, the Battle of Uhud, and later on to achieve the conquest of Mecca. I say this and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness for all of us. Ask for his forgiveness. He is all forgiving, all merciful.